So we were discussing instruction set architecture. So last time we talked about basic definition. So last time we stopped here, classifying instructions based on number of operands. Okay, right. So we looked at three register operands, zero memory operands, one memory, one register, two memory, zero register, three memory, zero register, and so on, right? And the main point here was that if you want to have a memory operand, the obvious thing that you have to do is that you have to encode at least one memory address in the instruction. So, and a memory address is typically large, depending on the size of the address space in the instruction. It could be 32 bits, it could be 64 bits. So that takes space and that makes your instructions larger, instruction size, right? Whereas in a machine, number of registers could be very small, normally small, 32, 8, 16 of that range, number of registers exposed to the program. Okay. So in that case, a register address would be just 5 bits, 4 bits. Okay. So if you have register operands, your instructions are going to be smaller in size. However, an instruction with memory operand has an advantage. That is, if you look at one instruction that is, let's suppose that is doing an addition, adding up two memory operands. Okay. Let's take this one. So adding up a memory operand with a register operand and putting the result in, let's say, a memory operand. Alright. So it has two memory operands, the instruction, and one register operand. Okay, alright. So here what you are actually doing is you are doing three operations together. You are loading a value from a memory address into your processor, some register, internal register, adding that internal register value with this register's value, putting it somewhere inside the processor, again some register that is not exposed to the programmer, and then storing that register value back to the memory location. So if you want to do that in a machine which does not have memory operands, you'll have to actually have three instructions. Okay. So that would affect your code density. So there's a clear trade-off between instruction size and code density. All right. In this classification, and we'll further see certain other aspects. For example, if you have memory operands, usually it's very difficult to pipeline. Okay. So we'll see why that is so. And it will of course have impact on execution time, because we said that execution time is a combination of three parameters: the cycles per instruction, number of instructions, and your cycle time, right? So we have already seen that number of instructions is going to get affected, the code density, depending on what encoding we actually choose. Okay. And yeah, so number of bits for register encoding. So we'll as we go along, we'll look at these trade-offs more. Okay. Any question? So let's start with memory addressing. So this is a very important component of every instruction set architecture. Okay. So by the way, somebody asked last time, I'll just reiterate that once more, that what comes first? Is it the instruction set or the architecture? Okay, right? So the first thing that you do when designing a machine is the instruction set architecture. Okay, that is, which instructions my processor is going to have. Okay. And your processor is essentially an implementation of the instruction set. When you try to implement the instruction set, what you get is essentially the processor. Okay. So this is what decides what your processor will do, what your processor will look like. So as I said last time, if you make a gross mistake in defining your instruction set, there is no way you are going to have a good processor, however smart designers you may have in your team. Okay. Alright. So memory addressing is an integral part of your instruction set, which decides how you would address the memory. Alright. So accessing a value in memory requires two things. One is the starting address of the value that you want to access, and how many bytes you want to access, the length of the value. All right. So load store register instruction set architectures. So just to remind you what this is, you might have forgotten. This one doesn't allow any, this one allows memory operands only in load store instructions. Does not allow any memory operands in ALU instructions. All right. So a load instruction will have one memory operand, one register operand. So the load instruction will take the value from the memory operand and put the value in the register operand. Okay. A store instruction would similarly take the value from a register operand and store the value back to the memory operand. Okay. So these architectures normally encode the length in the opcode. Okay. So what this means is that they offer different instructions for different lengths. Okay. For example, if you want to access a byte in memory, okay, for that there will be a separate instruction. If you want to access a half word is 2 bytes. So these particular types are taken directly from MIPS. Okay, but they may vary from processor to processor. Okay, all right. So here I define half word to be 2 bytes. If you want to access half word, you'll have another instruction. If you want to access a word, which is 4 bytes, you will have one more other instruction. If you want to access double word or 8 bytes, that will have one more instruction. Okay. So type becomes implicit in the opcode itself. Okay. Sorry, not type, the data length. Okay. How many bytes you want to access. And access for x bytes normally needs to be, that is, if you are trying to access, let's say, x bytes starting at address, then address modulo x must be 0. Why? Any idea why should it be? This is called an aligned access. And if this condition doesn't hold, that's called a non-aligned access. So in most processors, or at least in some processors, you'll find that this is one requirement, that address modulo x must be 0. Why is that? Which means if I want to do a load word, for example, I can only start at an address which is a multiple of 4. I cannot start at an arbitrary place. Any clue why this should be? I'm not saying that this is a requirement for every processor. In fact, one of your most popular processors do not require this. But this simplifies matters a lot. Why is that? Any idea?
It reduces the number of, it reduces the size of the memory.
Reduces the size of the memory.
If we choose x as 4, mm-hmm. then we can reduce the, we need not consider the last 2 bits, 0, to decrease the instruction size.
I see, okay. But that would be the, okay, so you're saying that if x is the power of 2, then I can decrease the size of the address in instruction. That's a good observation, but we'll see that we can solve that problem otherwise, some other way. There are other reasons for this.
Memory is in multiples of 2.
Memory is in multiples of 2.
Suppose like 2 to the power 10.
Is that called a multiple of 2? Multiple of 2 is 6 is also. I'm sorry? 6 is also a multiple of 2.
Power of 2.
Power of 2. Okay. Alright.
Mm-hmm. So if you are suppose that at the end, somewhere around, suppose that 1024 bytes is the memory, and if you are accessing 1021. And okay. You are trying to access 4 bytes, okay. Then in that case it may fail. If we give a restriction that only multiples of 4 should be allowed, means when you are accessing...
No, I'll allow all of these. A load byte instruction can start anywhere. A load half word instruction has to start on an even address. A load word instruction will start at addresses multiple of 4, and double word will start.
If we take the case of 4,
yeah.
Then we should access starting from 1020, okay. Or 1116, like that.
Uh-huh.
If we are starting from 1021, uh-huh. Then it may fail. Means it will access 3 bytes.
Okay, so byte okay. So what you are suggesting is that there is something that is power of 2 in memory.
Yeah.
Which is why if we assert this, then we'll guarantee that we'll never straddle that boundary. Right? All accesses will finish by that boundary. What is that power of 2? What is it actually? 1024 you said in your answer. What is it?
It's size of memory.
Size of memory.
Yeah.
Why is that important? Size of memory? I give you 4 gigabyte of memory.
Okay. That is also 2 to the power 50.
Yes, that's a power of 2. But I'll have a problem only at the end, right? Just one access memory. Which is why I would restrict that. Anybody else? So he is close. He has brought up an issue with power of 2. Indeed, it has something to do with power of 2. Yes.
So the thing is that if we read like 8 bytes and the remaining are 2 or 3, we would be unnecessarily doing that. But instead, what it would help us that it would break it down to the last chunk of those 3-4 bytes, and then we would again drop down to 4, 2, and 1 simultaneously.
No, reading, like, what is this 8-byte thing you're talking about?
So if we have a large data to read,
last means.
So, when so instead of doing it last, we would have it first. So if we have something like 31 bytes to read.
Okay.
So first it would do 1 byte, then we would have 30 bytes to read, then it would go with...
Well, 31 can be decomposed in various
decomposed. So it would help us decompose that, that's what I'm saying. Because for majority of time during that it would read in chunks of 8 bytes,
yeah.
But when it can't read 8 bytes, it would reduce it.
That is fine, but what does it have to do
so
with this?
Because if we read, so if we don't do that, then we would unnecessarily doing the 8 byte reading even if we don't have the 8 bytes.
Can you give an example? I'm not following what you're saying, I'm sorry. Can you give an example? Concrete values? So that not enforcing this would actually break your whatever you're suggesting.
Suppose only 3 bytes are left and we would be root.
No, what do you mean by left? That's what I'm asking. So end of the world or something, or what is it? What is meant by left? Nothing beyond that?
There is something beyond that, but okay. We would be unnecessarily reading that. So let's say it would be reading.
No, left to what? I mean, what is that? After 3 bytes, what is going to happen?
So the 5 bytes that are left, that would
5 bytes now, okay, alright. No, but you have to define what is meant by left.
So that is a garbage value for us.
Beyond this point.
Beyond the point, yeah. That's
what is this point?
So that's the load instruction that we are getting. So you read this much data.
How much data?
So
give me a number. How much data do you want to read? I'm just trying to get an example from you. Give me some number. You load 4 bytes. 8 bytes. What is it? So what I'm not able to understand is what is it that you mean by saying 5 bytes are left? Left in what? Do you see what I'm asking? Or yeah, so can you just articulate what you're thinking in your head? There must be something, right? Why you're saying this. What is it?
So I actually so we would have these only instructions. I thought that we would have a instruction side. So
okay. Anybody else? Yes, yeah.
So the boundary value of the memory block.
Boundary value of the memory block. Can you define what a memory block is?
So the memory controller at the memory level will read it block by block. So the
typically what is a block? Can you give a size?
I think it was MKB.
In kilobytes. When you request memory some data, how much data do you get back, usually?
7 bytes.
No, I mean, what is it? Who is requesting? Sorry?
The boundary that we are talking about, like the...
Yes, no, I understand. The boundary that we are talking about is a memory block. I am just trying to ask you, what is a typical size of a block? What determines a block, memory block?
The inode structures.
No, that's the file system. No. That's the file system.
So
sorry?
So word size.
Word size.
Means whatever the word size is for CPU, that will it will return that much block.
Is that right? Is that so? normally where do you look up this data? When you try to, when the CPU tries to access data, where does it go first? Yes?
Cache.
Is there something called a cache block size? So that's what the memory will return, right? And the cache block size is typically 64 bytes, 32 bytes, 128 bytes, 256 bytes, probably not more than that, right? So that is the boundary that we are talking about. Okay. If I do not enforce this, the chances are that I may end up accessing a particular piece of data in an instruction, part of which is in one cache block, part of which is in another cache block, which actually requires doing two memory accesses with one instruction, which is not a very good thing. Okay. So here, keep in mind that since we are allowing x to take only these values, there is some assumption about block size here, which is a power of 2. And that is why you need to enforce this. Okay, so if you design a new machine where x could take other values, then this particular condition might change. Alright? Is it clear to everybody? Okay. So these are called aligned accesses. X86 does not actually enforce aligned accesses. Your Intel processors actually can handle unaligned accesses as well, right? But we'll talk about one processor, that is MIPS, which actually does not allow unaligned accesses. You have to do all aligned accesses. And this is compiler's job actually, to produce addresses which are aligned, right? Okay. However, in any case, an alignment network is needed for loads. Can somebody decrypt this particular statement? So I've just said that this particular condition holds. So if you have a load instruction of 4 bytes, we know that the address will be at a boundary of 4 bytes. It's a multiple of 4. We know that.
Okay.
But then I say that, well, even then I need an alignment network. What is this network doing actually? What is the meaning of an alignment network? Can anybody guess? Think about a load byte instruction. And remember that the load instruction will first look up the cache. And there is a cache block size which is usually bigger than any of these things. And your load byte instruction, what is the destination? It's a register, right? You will read that those 8 bits out, a byte is basically 8 bits, right? And put those 8 bits in the register. And what is a typical register size in a machine? Sorry? 32 bits? 64 bits. Right? So when you talk about a 32-bit machine, the register size is 32 bits. You talk about 64-bit machine, you talk about 64 bits is the register. So a load byte instruction at the end will go to a register, and that byte will sit in the least significant byte of those 4 byte register. Okay, right? So now can somebody guess what this alignment network is doing? You have a load byte instruction, you have to read the byte from the cache and put the byte in the least significant byte within the register. I have already told you what it does. Can somebody summarize? What is it aligning actually? Yeah? It shouldn't be too difficult.
It's like byte.
Can somebody? Okay. Yeah.
Because the byte is broken into two parts, so it's aligning that two labels.
Byte is broken up into two parts.
Yes, we have a 32-bit instruction, I mean 32-bit L size.
32-bit is the register size.
Yeah, register size.
Okay, alright.
So our byte is broken up to two parts.
Two so parts. What are these?
We have 8-byte word size, right?
Don't bring up the word size. Forget about it for now. There is nothing like a word size. I have a load instruction which has to bring 8 bytes from the cache into a register. And if you really want to think about the word size, in this particular case, I don't know what you exactly mean by the word size. Can you explain? Then I can tell you.
So at the moment we can read 8
okay, all right. Together. This is going to be this one in this particular machine because this is the max.
Yeah.
Okay.
So as here we can read only 4 bytes at a time because
8 bytes. Is the word size in this case?
As I said, it's only 4 bytes.
Four bytes, right?
So from these 8 bytes, will broke up into two parts.
Okay.
And 4 bytes in one register, 4 bytes in one register. So
no. It's a load byte instruction. I'm just loading a byte. Okay. Yeah. So see, if you think about the data path size, if you're talking about, I don't know what you're talking about by word size. If you're talking about a bus that leads from the cache to register file, that will be 4 bytes because the register is 32 bits. Okay. Any data that comes from the cache to register will have to be 32 bits. Okay. Right? But the maximum that you can read out from the cache is 64 bits. You have to be, because otherwise you cannot execute the double word instructions.
So we are supposed to align that, right?
Align what?
As we are reading the 8 bytes from cache, but we can only save 4 bytes in register. So we are supposed to align it.
Align. So, okay. So align what?
These 8 bytes.
With respect to what? No, but in this case, I'm only reading a byte. That's what I'm saying. It's a load byte instruction. Okay, I'll give you the answer. You're close. You've got it actually. So in this case, this is my data path width. So from one go, the cache will provide me 4 bytes. Okay, all right. Now from the 4 bytes, I have to get the designated byte, and it can be anywhere in these 4 bytes, right? Because for a byte load, the condition is only address modulo 1, right? Which can be anything actually. So suppose that out of these 4 bytes, the required byte sits in the most significant site. Okay. All right, it has to go to the least significant site of the register. So you need an alignment network. That's exactly what it is doing. It will rotate the bytes, align it to the right position, and then copy it to the register. Okay. All right, is it clear to everybody? So if you want to take a concrete example, suppose I'll specify a load byte instruction by LB, all right? Now I want to do a load byte from address 0x1, let's say, okay, to register R, okay, all right? So what will the cache controller do? It will take this address and figure out the 4 bytes falling in this address, okay? So it will be what? 0, 1, 2, 3, I need this one. Okay, all right. I need this byte, and this will go to a register R, and the register should have it here. Okay. So what the alignment network will do is that it will rotate it by 2 slots, and then move it on the bus. Essentially, it's we'll do a shift operation on this side. All right.
Is it clear to everybody? Okay.
On some computers, it's possible to access least significant parts of a register, for example, x86, and leaving the upper portions unaffected.
So why is the alignment network only used for loads and stores?
Yes, of course, yes. It's needed for stores also. Yeah. So this is just an example that I wanted to give. For all memory operations, you'll require an alignment network. Any question? So, intimately related to memory addressing is a concept called endianness. So this refers to byte ordering within a word and word ordering within a double word. Okay. Both of these. So here I'll talk about byte ordering within a word. Same rules will apply for word ordering within a double word. Okay. So little endian machines place the byte with address at the end 00 in the least significant position, that is the little end of the word. Okay. So I can take a word which is 4 bytes. Okay, so what is a 4 byte in this case? Alright. So what will be the address of a word which is aligned? It will have the least significant bits will be 00, 01. 10 and 11, right? For an aligned word, which starts at an address which is a multiple of 4. Okay. So what he's saying is that the little endian machine will place the byte address this in the least significant position. So this one will actually hold the least significant byte within this one in a little endian machine. Alright. In a big endian machine, it's exactly the opposite. The byte sitting here is actually the most significant byte within the world. Okay. Alright. So here are some examples. So alpha not there anymore today. Vax, old machine. You have only this one today, and this is a little endian machine. Alright. On the big endian side, MIPS is very much there in the embedded market. Sun UltraSpark, although they are not designing any new processors, but of course you can use them now. Motorola also again there in the mobile market. So this ordering remains transparent to the programmer as long as he or she does not try to access the byte as well as the word starting at the same address. So here is an example. Suppose I define an integer x to be this, okay, all right, it's a 32-bit number, right? And then what I do is I try to extract a byte from it by saying char star c equal to char star and x, and then I print star c. What do you get in a little endian machine? So, a little endian machine, what will be the outcome? Yes, somebody.
In little endian, it will be
78. Big endian?
12.
Any other answer? How many of you don't agree with this? How many of you agree with this? What happened to the rest? Undecided, is it? I hope the undecided folks understand that it cannot be something in the middle, right? Is that clear to everybody? It has to be here or there. We're talking about the ends, big end or the little end. Okay. So what you have said is correct. So this is in a little endian machine. So first of all, we need to understand what it is trying to do. It is trying to extract. So when you say char star c, char star and x, it is trying to extract the least significant byte of x. Is that clear to everybody? So that's C syntax. Okay. So when you say this, it is trying to extract the least significant byte from x. The question is, what is the least significant byte? In the little endian machine, we have just said that the byte with this address is the least significant byte. Okay. So byte with this address on little endian machine is this one. On the other hand, on a big endian machine, the least significant byte is going to be this one. Okay. So that, because it sits on the big end, all right. So this particular address is on the most significant side. And since this one is trying to extract the byte with this particular address, the 00, the last one actually, what you'll get is in big endian machine you'll get this, little endian machine you'll get this. Is it clear to everybody? This is very important. Okay. And in a double word, we have two words, right? You can apply the same thing about the word ordering there. Okay. So with a double word, the word with 0000 sorry. 000. Right. Yes. So, in a double word, the aligned double word, right? You are going to have two addresses, right? That is, if you look at the least significant bits in a double word, if you look at the words, so first of all, we are looking at the bytes, right, in a word. So here we are talking about 8 bytes. Right? Okay. This is my one word, this is another word. Okay. So 00, 01, 1011, and then this is going to be 100, so this is 101, 110, 111, right?
Okay.
So the word with this particular address will sit on which side of the double word? can be determined by the same rules. Alright. So I suggest that you go back and execute this program. This is not a program, by the way. You can make it a, convert it to a program. But of course, nothing surprising will happen if you execute on an Intel machine. You're going to get 78. Okay. If you can somehow find a Spark machine, we have Spark machines in the department. Okay. And execute this one, you'll get the next one. Right?
Is there any advantage of one over other?
No, there is no advantage. It's just two schools, two design philosophies. And whenever you try to make a Spark machine communicate with an Intel machine, the world falls apart. Because you have to make sure that, you know, things are okay. Okay, so now over time, the ways of addressing memory have evolved tremendously. So what I have done here is a list of things that that have come up in several processors over time, how to address memory. So these are called addressing modes. Okay. So how to specify an address in an instruction? And it could be specified in a register, it could be specified in memory, or it could be an immediate value inside an instruction. So we'll see example of each of these three, okay, as we go along the list. So there are 10 major addressing modes that have been proposed over time, and this machine called VAX had all of them. So this is called a register addressing mode, where you have just two operands. So in all this, actually, we have two operands. So in register addressing mode, what you're doing is you're actually not addressing memory. Okay, you're actually just adding two registers and putting the value in one of these, most probably R4. All right. So this is called register addressing mode. You're addressing the registers. You're not addressing memory. Keep in mind. Okay. Immediate addressing mode talks about how do you address a particular value, a constant in an instruction. Right, so that's called an immediate addressing. Again, don't get confused with a memory address. This is not a memory address. It's specifying a constant in the instruction. Okay, I want to add 3 to the value in R4. That's all it says. Okay, all right. Displacement addressing mode. This one is actually addressing memory. Okay, so what it's doing is it's taking the value in R1, adding 100 to that, and whatever you get is the memory address. All right. So often this is called the base register R1, and this is the displacement. Okay. Register indirect. So here essentially same as displacement. Displacement is 0. So it's a very special case of displacement addressing. All right. Indexed addressing, where you specify your memory address as sum of two register values. You add R1 and R2. What you get is basically your memory address, and the name comes from the fact that you can think of R1 as the base address of an array and R2 is the index into the array. Okay, alright. So what you are doing is you are actually accessing R1 indexed by R2. Okay. So you start at R1, add R2, wherever you get is the memory address. Alright. Direct or absolute address, you specify the memory address directly. Okay, so notice the difference between this and this. Okay, so the way we notationally, we put a parenthesis here, okay, specify an address. All right, so this is not a constant here. This is a constant, but this is an address. Memory indirect, this is probably the most complicated one. What you do is you take the value in R3, go to the memory location, all right, wherever R3 is pointing to. And whatever the content of that location is your final address. Okay, so pictorially this is what it does. So this is your R3. It has some value, right? You use it as an address that points to some memory location here. Okay, it has some value. If you use that as an address, it will point to somewhere here. And this is the location that it is referring to, this particular one. Okay, that's called memory indirect. Yes. Auto increment, this one actually encapsulates two operations. This one first does a register indirect memory access, and then once this operation is done, it automatically increments the value of R3. Okay. What is the application of this instruction? Can anybody think of anything? Sorry? Okay. Exactly, right. So if you want to access an array, you would initialize your R3 to the base of the array and that is it. You would just put an auto increment instruction in that. Okay. What will happen is that automatically R3 will move along. Okay, all right. Similarly, you have auto decrement. If you want to start at the end of the array, you can gradually proceed towards the head. And finally, you have scaled. This is essentially a combination of two things, indexed and displacement. Okay. So I don't know if you can think of anything else outside this list, how to address memory. Okay. Of course, you can put one more at here to get memory indirect, but you know, fundamentally everything is pretty much here. Okay.
What is the use of indexed addressing mode?
Yeah, so well, if you just want to, you require a separate instruction for incrementing R2 if you want to go along and access everything. Yeah, but as such, this is just, you know, giving you an indexed location into an array. So although VAX had all these addressing modes, it should be obvious that we don't need all these actually. Okay. If you analyze programs, what we'll find is that these addressing modes will appear with different frequencies. Some would be very, very rare, some would be highly frequent. Okay, right? So you have to choose the effective modes only, because it has implication on complexity, CPI and instruction count. Okay. Because on one hand, you would like to choose very complicated addressing modes because that would reduce your instruction count. Okay. Because that would encapsulate very complicated memory addresses in a single instruction like this one. Okay. All right. On the other hand, implementing these instructions will be a nightmare. That would probably increase your CPI and also complexity. So typically what you do is you take programs, analyze them and find out which addressing modes are most frequent. Okay. You definitely support them, all right? And the rest depends on how much complexity you can afford, okay, or how much the CPI will get affected if you implement the remaining addressing modes. So large number of addressing modes normally increase complexity, decrease instruction count, assuming the target applications and the compiler can exploit them. However, they may increase CPI. Designers normally simulate the target benchmarks to see the relative usage of the addressing modes. For example, these are very old example taken from a text. On the VAX machine, immediate and displacement modes are most heavily used by tech, SPICE and GCC benchmarks. Okay. Memory indirect, scaled, register indirect, in addition to the above two, cover almost all memory accesses. So you could actually do away with the remaining ones, in fact. Okay. We had 10 things in that list, out of which, in fact, 5 pretty much cover everything. Okay. Register indirect could really be displacement. So register indirect was, yeah. So as I said, this is a special case of displacement. So this is a typical analysis that an architect would do before deciding your addressing modes. So VAX designers argued that the frequency of usage depends on programming language and compiler, so they did not take any risk. They said, well, we'll put all 10. Alright. And probably what they have done in doing so is that they might have sacrificed CPI for commonly occurring programs. Okay. To probably speed up some program which is obscure, may run maybe once in 10 years or something. Alright. So before going along, you have to decide a few things. So the displacement mode, just to remind you once more what it was, we have to somehow encode this particular constant. Right? It's a displacement. Okay. So at the design time, you have to decide how big a displacement can I support, because that will have implication on your instruction size, because this has to go inside the instruction. The instruction has to tell me that, you know, you should have R1, you should have 100, you should have R4. At the proper places in the instruction. This usually instruction, when you design an instruction, it should have slot for the source register, it will have slot for the destination register, you will have some slot for the displacement also in this list. Okay. And how big a displacement to decide how big the instruction is. So it varies a lot. Turns out that zero displacement is most frequent. Okay. And again here you do the same thing. You take benchmark applications, study them and find out the statistics that, well, tell me the histogram of displacements. Okay. I have seen maybe in this entire benchmark suite, I have seen maybe hundreds of billions of load store instructions. Give me the displacement histogram for this. Okay. So from that it turns out that zero displacement is the most frequent one. Okay. And most displacements are usually positive. You seldom have negative displacements. But again, you have to keep in mind that these are all conditioned upon what the compiler is doing. So, because you have to remember the compiler is actually generating these instructions. Okay. Large displacements requiring 14 plus bits are normally negative because so they need sign extension. So, we'll talk about this soon, what that actually means. Those who have who remember a little bit about binary addition might remember what sign extension means and why that is needed. But anyway, we'll talk about that in the next lecture. Storage layout and hence programming language may influence the displacement size. That's the that you have to keep in mind. But anyway, the takeaway point here is that zero displacements are frequent, most displacements are positive, and positive displacements are usually small. Okay. All right. So what this means is that you are fine if you have small number of bits devoted to displacement. So we'll see what MIPS did exactly in the next lecture. How many bits are devoted to displacement model. Any question on this? Is it clear? Okay. Similarly, the immediate mode, same question arises. How big a constant can I put in my instruction? Okay, right? So here of course there is a very clear trade-off. If I find that my program has mostly large constants and I cannot put them in the instruction, that means I have to store them in memory. That would require extra instruction to bring them to the processor actually. As opposed to if I can put all of them inside my instruction, then when the instruction is fetched, the value will come along with that actually. Okay. All right. So it's used for moving constants, also used in arithmetic operations, comparisons. So two major questions, which instructions should support the immediate mode, number one. Okay. So clearly arithmetic instructions should support the immediate mode because I would definitely require manipulating constants. Okay. I would require adding a constant, I would require multiplying a constant, I might require dividing a constant, I might require logically operating on a constant like logical ANDing, ORing, XORing or all those things. So and of course I should probably require this in the memory instructions because if I want to specify an absolute address, I should be using the immediate mode. How many bits should be devoted to the immediate? Same question as displacement. Okay. How big a constant can I put in an instruction? So load immediate and ALU immediate instructions are most frequent. So these instructions, load immediates are not really loads. These are just moving a constant to a register. They do not access memory. All right. So again, if you look at the benchmark statistics, you'll find that small immediate values are heavily used in arithmetic. Also, you can think about the programs that you have written in your life and ask how many times have I used a very large constant. Probably you wouldn't find too many cases. Okay. In most cases, you would be using small constants. In most cases, actually zero is a heavily used constant. Okay. Large immediate values are normally used for address constants like some global offset and all those things. Okay. So usually these are anyway kept in registers. So we'll talk about which registers are used for keeping these global addresses and all. Okay.